What's up? That song's kind of cool. It's got some weird noises to it. Man, all these auto hosts, you guys are awesome. Hostile G-Force, dude man. Dude man. Tukey. Holy crap, Tashir. Tasha Nur. I'm saying that totally wrong. It's cool though. It's cool. Thanks for the host, man. Visceral, thanks for the host. Man, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, Mandel, what's up? Hello? Fiva. Makes me think about Italian Spider-Man for some reason. Italian Spider-Man. If you don't know what that is, you definitely need to YouTube it. So how are you guys doing? I feel like there's gonna be spillage in this room tonight. You don't dare YouTube? Why not, man? Oh, Chris. I'm sorry I couldn't get coffee with you all day today. I was so busy. Winky dink. All right. So I've got a bottle of water. I've got leftover smoothie, which is a smoothie I haven't finished yet here. I've got, I guess we'll switch to this shot. Got this whole bad boy. This looks like a bad idea, doesn't it? Oh man, this music's getting me pumped. Need to get a haircut, dude. I don't know about this one. Was making badass art? That's what it's about, dude. Oh, this is good stuff. Okay, so I said in the Discord, if you're not part of the Discord, you can go here. Welcome everyone that's just new here. I said in Discord we were going to talk about building modular building stuff. Galen, thanks for the host. You guys are getting all hosts today. This is awesome. You guys are awesome. Here's the thing I gotta finish here. Galen. Oh, dude, by the way, beard's awesome. Have to say, pretty cool. What's up, Reto? Okay. Oh yeah, I'll fire this off because this happened while the stream was not live. Boom, Milikov, $25 Adoni. Thanks, dude. Super appreciated. Panion, what's up, man? I see you lurking. Before we get into that, I said in the Discord as well that there was a small, tiny announcement, super tiny. Twitch Purple. Okay, so I'm trying to get a Patreon set up, and I don't know if I'm going to fully follow through with it yet or not. I'm still on the fence about it. But what I do need to test is part of the Patreon design is to have nightly critiques, which just saying it, I feel like that's going to be a lot of work. So I want to get 10 people to try it out. Just message me on the Discord, Tay Discord, just direct message me. And when I hit 10 people, I'll let the Discord know that I have 10 people. And essentially what will happen is next week, starting on Monday, whatever you're posting, if your name is on that list, I'll make a channel in the Discord. And if you're posting critiques or images to be critiqued in there, what's up, Clancy? If you post critiques in there, in that channel, I will grab the first 5 people for that day and critique their stuff in a video that night. And I'll do that every day minus the stream days, right? So Monday, it would be Monday, Wednesday, and Friday that you would get a critique. The idea is that you would do that every day for the month or whatever that you would be paying in the Patreon. But I want to make sure that I can do that beforehand. So we're going to start with 10 people. Just direct message me. And Chris, thanks for the... Who's viewing your channel? It's crazy. But that is a lot. So yeah, I want to make sure. The idea is that I won't stream it. It will be offline. I will just let you know in the channel. What's up, Gail? Go. OP? Double views, yo. Oh, Chris, you're awesome. So just message me on Discord and we can get you figured out and added to that list. The list will be reported viewbot. Discord is here. Go ahead and just join that and then message me if you want to be on that list. And then next week we will have that sorted and we will try it out for, I don't know, a week or two. Just to see how it feels. But yeah, cool. Okay. Let's talk about modular stuff. So Modo's a little weird when it comes to scale, as far as like knowing how big something is or how small, measurement wise. Let's do that. So the grid, as you can see when I'm doing this, is scaling. And you can't see in the bottom right here, but it's telling me what each grid piece is. What's up, Ben? How you doing, dude? It's not telling you, or it's just auto-scaling. And as you zoom in or zoom out, the grid pops and changes size, which is really good. In the bottom right, it will tell you. You can't see it because of the UI, but in the bottom right, it tells you. Actually, I'll just do this. I'll do this really fast. Just raise this up. So see right here, when you zoom in and out, you can see it's changing metrics. I always use CM, yeah, as a metric. I'm doing some measurements at work right now, and it's crazy. So because we're talking about measurements, I'm going to show some of this stuff. Let's get the, so when you're working with modular stuff, you want to try and like ground a corner to the center origin. And if you go up here to view and you go dimensions tool, it'll show you the dimensions of whatever you have selected. So you can see this is 1 meter by 1 meter. If I do this, you can say 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter cube. When you move this, you can see that you're getting some values. So it's 65 or 665 millimeters in. And the only reason you're seeing that information, I believe, let me see if I can find it. Preferences. Oh, I'm vibrating. Hey, what's up? What's up, Tobias? Let me make sure this is muted. It's Matt. What's Matt doing? I don't know. He's sending photos to me. He must be at the gym or something. Just check out these guns. Although he's probably spinning, so he's like, check out these guns. Let's see if we can find... I'm doing good. How are you, Tobias? I always thought your last name said Forgeling. I'm probably even saying it wrong when I say Forceling. Alright, where are we at here? I already forgot where it's at because I just turned it on by default. Tool handles, there we go. So you want tool handles, you want draw style, you want the selected tool handles to be advanced. Usually it's basic. By switching it to advanced, you get to see value manipulation that's happening, and then if you like bevel this edge, you get to see a UI representation of it pop up on the screen, which actually is interactive. So you can grab this and drag it around. And as you go beyond the range of the bar, the values update, which is super cool. You remember when he tried to say his last name? What's up, Nock? How you doing, dude? Well, you guys are flooding in now. It's 31 of you. How you doing? How's everyone? So this is super cool, having this type of information that's up. And then if you don't want this, you just hit escape and it'll go away, which is, it's a blessing and a curse at the same time. So I maybe suggest hotkeying the dimensions tool. There's also a ruler, which is kind of interesting. It's just 2 points that you can, well, if you have snapping on, you can just snap it to points. Be like, oh, okay, that's that. Another nice thing while we're talking about metrics, let's press K and bring up the tool property. So when you're moving, start snapping off. When you're moving, you can see the value shifting there. Let's say, this is weird. Let's say that you want to move it by, instead of negative 500 millimeters, let's say you want to move it by minus, you want to do negative 1 foot, 12 inches. And you press enter, and it converts that to millimeters, or the centimeter metric, and then does it, and then tells you what the end result is, which honestly I find insane. So you know, see, I zoomed out now and I've made the grid. It's a meter by meter grid. Let's see, what else can I show you that involves this thing? Okay, so let me go to the regular Moto UI for a minute so I can show you. Okay, so you have this cube, right? This, what's up, Game Art 101? How you doing? Okay, so if you select this mesh, there's a, I guess you don't have to select a mesh, but snaps and precision. There's a thing in here called absolute scaling. This, I'm still getting used to it, but man, it is awesome. So you just have this up. And let's grab this. We'll duplicate it over here, and I'll just make it all types of. It's gonna be all wrong. Well, we'll make it the right one. So that's the right one. So when you grab an object, you can grab size, and it will give you all the scale information of the X, Y, and Z of the object selected. You can also do it by face, and it'll just give you the information you need. I think you can do it by edge as well. Yeah. So let's grab size on this, and let's scale it to, like, so this is 500 millimeters. So we'll round everything. So let's make this one too. And then you just click explicit scale, And now it is 500 millimeters by 2 meters by 2 meters. Now, this thing gets super awesome. How does the metric translate when exporting? Because you can export settings according to what unit you want. Let me show this absolute scaling thing. This thing's awesome. Maybe you don't want this to scale, because you see it scales in every direction. We can grab size on this, and you can tell it to look at the Y and make it lower Y, lower X, and lower Z. So it'll all be scaling at the bottom corner of this asset. So then you can do like 500 millimeters, 2 meters by 2 meters, whoops. And then explicit scale, and it will do that while maintaining this corner down here. So then I believe low on the Y, low on the X, and low on the Z would put you at one corner. So everything will scale to like this corner vert here. What's up, Res? How's Moto's Retopo tools compared to Mac's opinion? That is completely off the topic. It's good, man. They have an auto Retopo tool now. It's good. I think it's pretty awesome. So now that you know that, this is where I'm like, that's kind of cool. You can grab the size of this object, double click this object, and then you can explicitly scale that one and actually give it the same properties as this one. And like maybe this side is down like this. Let's say it's down by 4. And what are we doing here? Minus 400 millimeters. And you grab that. If you still scale it, it's going to look at it as if it's a box, and it will maintain the same curve or angle. Useless pinion, useless. What's up, 3D Licks? How you doing, man? Mango is delicious. There's like papaya in there too or something. And some frozen bag of goodies. I'm reading chat to make sure everything's good. Yeah, Chris, you gonna stream some more art, some more gameplay? That'd be awesome. Okay, so let's get this into place here. You just handed in your dude. Raz is the man. If you guys could spam chat for Raz, that's freaking awesome. My OCD was fine with it. That's amazing. So let's start covering a little bit of the basics of modular stuff for building pieces. So we're gonna go. I'm just gonna make the walls. I'm gonna make them like 200 thick, just for the sake of things. Let's grab this and let's make it. Let's make it 5 meters tall. And we'll do 5 meters wide as well. Whoa, look at this. Make sure you select everything, guys. Hype. Yes, congrats, dude. That's a big deal. Can you get a value on the angles as well? I don't think you can, actually. I know that there's a protractor. I've never, I mean, I'm going to be honest, I've never used this thing before. Like, I don't even, like, what's happening? No. Yeah, I've never used a protractor. I don't even know how that thing works. But there is a protractor. That would be pretty awesome, though, if they had some, like, absolute... size absolute. Yeah, absolute scaling is super powerful. Do it, Rez. Do it. Okay, so... we've got a wall that's a 5x5 meter. And the thickness is 200 millimeters. That should be fine. When you zoom out here, if you go to 1 meter, whoa, what the fuck? Hang on here. Okay, yeah, we're good. I got super confused there for a second. So, okay, I'm gonna go back to the Zen UI because I feel more comfortable in here. Zoom out. Okay, that block is 5 meters, so if you zoom in enough, you can see that you have 5 meter increments. Next up, let's say that this is, we're gonna go with the block out phase first. So it's really important when you're doing modular stuff to do block out first and make sure that all aligns, because getting stuff to snap together in the most simplest form will guarantee that as long as you're maintaining that same scale, everything will snap together. What's Reed's talking about? The tool works just like you tried to do it. Just choose the world direction in the tool properties. I mean, if I'm like in here. I mean, you can do that, right? But that's, I don't know what Reed's talking about. I'm sure it's amazing. We're talking about Reed here, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I usually like to have my back corner of a building piece, back left corner, so we're facing the front of it. I usually like to have the back left corner be the vert that's snapped to the Reeds, you don't have to worry about it. I don't know what's happening. Yeah, I usually like to have the back corner of a modular piece in said location. So it's really important, I think, to have all the snapping working from the get-go. So going with basic shapes is going to be your best bet for making sure that everything works. And as long as everything works, as far as snapping goes here, everything else will be perfect. Let me know if the music's a little intense. It's a little crazier than usual. Oh, I already see, what is that? Hang on. Oh. There, do you see it? Do you see it? Discrepancies, can't handle it. Anywho. Let's delete this guy. So we need to make, oh geez. You have to have, whoa. Oh, that's V. Still getting used to this Zen UI stuff, man. It's crazy. So, Chris, I'd actually be curious to see how you do a 45-degree angle turn. Because, I mean, you can do a couple of things, right? Because you can do, like, symmetry, which gets kind of weird. Like, if I do this. And this music's freaking epic. Well, and I don't have any of my, oh, I need to keep that up. You're like, oh no, this needs to be 45. Great music, nice. I'm just gonna do this because it's here. This is a really weird way to make a corner. Corner pieces. I mean, as long as they're, I would say that you probably need to have this as a meter. So, another way that I've done measurements in the past is doing this, where you just position it directly on top of the corner point. And then if you start scaling this way and then just say minus one, you'll have 1 meter. So you're just essentially zeroing it out. You just move it. You just move it to that point, drop the tool, then reopen it, and then move it by whatever amount that you need. Just dial it in. I feel like something is wrong. No. All right. God, my brain is telling me there's a weird angle thing going on. Yeah, you just control snap to a certain angle. Yeah, and it's usually, yes. Yeah, so if you... if you go here and you zoom out, so that's 1 meter. You can see on the grid, and then by we need to make sure this is 1 meter. Let's go back like that. So we're just gonna put everything on the inside. So right now these are kind of on top of each other. Let's put this, make this a corner. And this one, this wall, 5x5. This music is kind of crazy. Okay, so now we have these two pieces. Like, you can make, let's say, I'll just paste this one, and oh, come on. I want this one. There we go. There's hiding selected. Wow, okay. This material is really hard to see. I wonder if it's because I'm in shaded. There we go. It was! Okay, so let's just bevel this. Um, 1.5. Let's say this is gonna be our super exciting window. Oh yeah, if let me see if this works. Yeah, so if you select so bridging, right? If I do this, bring this up, you can select faces and do a bridge, and it should just solve, like, you can see this line's a little bold. You make sure to delete that. But for this example, we'll just do this. So if I select these two faces and I bridge them, it'll just like cut out the window. Tileable masks from Substance Painter. 3D looks at, I'm gonna get to masks at some point here, because there's some stuff you have to deal with when it comes to making masks for modular parts, especially when you want the parts to be interacting with each other. There's a couple things you can do, but they're not the end result is pretty, but they tend to be a little janky when it comes to how they're done. Oh, that's weird. I just realized, is my chat not showing on stream? I'm pouring coffee. Oh my god, this looks so good. So good. Oh my gosh. That coffee's like the darkness. Oh, so strong. Oh yeah, chat is working. Okay, cool. Okay, so now we're looking at this guy. Like, you can go through and optimize it if you want. It might not be worth it right now, mainly because it's just block out. But we'll just do it. Okay, so we got this piece now as well. So theoretically, we should be able to just snap our pieces around. Like, say we're in Unreal. I'll just rotate this. Actually, before I do this. Probably shouldn't call that stuff stream examples. There you go. Modular building. Okay, so we've got, now that I've saved this, I'm just gonna move these pieces around wherever I want. So now with these pieces, we can do a decent amount of stuff. I'll just move that off to the side. Sure, I guess we could instance this stuff, but I'm just kind of showing you what we can do. Now remember too, if you end up using this corner piece in both directions, like if you need, let's do, you're gonna need to support it on both sides in order to make sure that it makes sense. The other thing you wanna do too is, while you're building these, you probably should be making sure that you're unwrapping them nicely. So like, I don't want that. So if I grab this face, Huh. Oh man, it's been a while since I've had to do this manually. Cause you want to be able to fit this as well. Like, this. There's a definitely an easier way to do this. I believe I have a script that just fits it to the UV space. So let's just invert that. So now knowing that this is unwrapped, fitting the 0 to 1 space in the UVs, as long as you do that with this next piece, we'll just hide that so we can just look at this. Project from view. I think it's just if I just, see, that's not even doing it in the right direction though. But essentially you have to get these, all your UVs to line up 0 to 1. So they all snap on this grid. It's the only way you'll get seamless UVs. Man, I'm making this look like such a pain in the ass, but there's easier ways to do this. Anyway, so let's say these UVs are essentially lining up. So where it ends here. Oh, see, I even have it backwards. So, okay, so where this is, you have to know upside down from right side up. Do that. There we go. Okay, so where these meet, it's just seamless, right? This should just tile across. You have to make sure that happens for every piece. And that way, the way they're lining up just works. The other thing to do is possibly building those so that they're using world space UVs. If they're using world space UVs and they're squared off like that, where their corner will happen, as long as the corner is happening on a on the edge of the 0 to 1 space, the world space should line up and just tile across the other direction and be seamless as well there. Now, when it gets into a little bit more detail, at least how we deal with it at work, sometimes you'll bevel these, depending on how big the wall is. If this is like the building system for like a huge city, might not be a good idea to bevel every single corner modular piece. And in that case, we, or at least I do it like this. So if I duplicate the corner piece and hide all these pieces. All right, this song's too weird for me. As it goes into another weird song. If you bevel, so I duplicate the corner piece. Bevel the edge, like how big I would want the decal to be. Go in and make the edge shape. I think it's, yeah, sharp or square. Yes. Okay, so you just make it square. Say that's the edge. Select these, invert the selection and delete it. Then make this edge soft. And you should Did I just delete like Yeah, I did. Hang on. Make sure everything is here. It's like I just deleted everything. This is why it sucks to be demoing this like modular pieces in here. Okay, get rid of this. So if I duplicate this, oh, you know what? No, I'm fine. Corner. What am I even doing? So we've got this corner piece, right? Then we've got this, what the hell was that? This song is weird. So now we've got corner piece, and then we've got a detail normal edge. I'm like getting lost in my own. Okay, do this. I'll turn the corner back on. Hide unselected. So this piece here, you just have to take that and push it ever so slightly. I think push is, where are we at here? To push this out, very, very small amount. And then if you soften this edge, and then you get a normal mapped on that. Later, knock. You get a tileable detail normal on this edge. You can essentially imitate more detail than there actually is on the corner of this beam. And you can change the, like, how wide the, it's a little hacky, but if you do that and then you scale, you can tighten that up a little bit. And then you just need to make sure that you're not seeing a seam where the normal ends. I'm like, why is it? There we go. Full weighting. Not full weighting on. I'm like, why does it look shit? Gosh. So if I widen this up, you can see the effect. So yeah, you just get a detailed tile normal that goes top to bottom tiling of like chipped patterns, and you should be good. Chris, I don't remember that. What are Korean bevels? Hey, thanks for the thanks for the follow. Is it Mainu? Mainu? 001. Thanks for the follow, dude. Or dudette. The other thing is, it's nice being in Modo. You can just, it's probably like this in other programs, but you could just call this edge decal for the shader. Just give your edges, I don't know, a red color. And then this mesh, just call this corner. Like a green. So now just looking at it, you know that it's supporting two shaders, and when you export out this single mesh container as a object in FBX, it should come in with two separate materials that you can just plug in two materials into. Okay, I gotta see this, Chris. Oh, we were like, what? Yeah. The intern life. Oh, Jopi, it's brutal. Yeah, I mean, in Modo, for the most part, I think it's pretty normal when you bevel like that. It shouldn't, like, I guess you would have to, I don't know, that bevel is a little weird, right? Because, so let's look at it here. So it's basically doing what we're talking about, but you just keep it in the mesh instead of subtracting it out. And you can see what it's doing with the normal on the edge here, is it just gets so much more shape to it, which You wanna kind of get away from the hard edge, because that's what makes stuff look like 3D or geometry. So when you get away from that by doing things like these bevels, that was big, man. I remember I remember this. I don't remember it being referred to as the Korean bevel. Yeah, because basically what you're doing is by adding these loops, you're putting control points onto where the, like, I have to delete these guys. Because I don't have to, but I delete that. If I bevel like this, this beveling should not be messing up the UVs. And then if I soften this edge, but make, let's just do this. We'll make everything a hard edge, and then we'll make this edge soft. And we need to... that. Like, what the fuck is happening? Okay, so we're gonna scale on that vert, and you can make sure slip UVs are on, and you should be able to just scale this. And you can see it looks high poly. Obvious 90 degree angles. Okay, let me read. Is Moto 10 worth upgrading from 902? I would say so, but I mean, the last update for Moto 10 just came out, so it might not be worth it now, since 11 will probably drop in a couple of months. I'd assume maybe 3 to 4 months from now. Moto 11, 1101 will make its appearance. I don't know, they're supposed to be on the 13th, there's supposed to be a live event for Moto from Foundry, or a live Foundry event for Moto. Melon, so any tricks for avoiding having things at obvious 90 degree angles when making modular pieces? Yeah, I mean, if you think about, let's see here. So if I take this piece, actually no, this is a bad piece to do this too. As long as you stay on the grid with your beginning and endpoint, we're just gonna go crazy on this. I'm gonna delete this piece. I'm gonna do like that. I'm gonna delete all these pieces. We'll leave those ones. So if you have this wall piece, right? Anything that happens between these two pieces is okay as long as it's on the grid. So like if you needed to, let me just do that. If you needed to, you could make this is a little bit of setup here. You could make a piece that essentially bridges the gap between a 5 meter by 5 meter offset. So instead of a 90 degree turn here, and then just a giant L, you essentially just take this piece and do that, right? And then you can do whatever you want to this. Kind of gets skewed over here, so you probably want to fix that. I feel like old school modeling right now. This is weird. Wait, I want to make sure this isn't rounded squared anywhere. So I mean, that's that right there is technically still modular. You just have this one unique piece, right? So, I mean, you can make essentially whatever you want, bridging the gap between two modular parts. Just try and, the important part is to try and stay on that grid. So the length of this wall, well, it changes distance of, here, if I turn this on, this will make it a little bit clearer, I think. So if I look from the top down, like this, it's 10 meters in length, so it's the length of two wall pieces. And for some reason, which it looks like I'm building this wrong, it's 5.2 meters distance. That is really weird. Let me see what that's about. I'm guessing that has to do with the wall thickness. It's like the wall thickness is 200 millimeters. So as I keep adding 200 millimeters, as I go this way, it offsets this piece. So this piece is 10 millimeters by 5.2 millimeters and still has the 5 meter height. But I mean, technically this still works because you're giving your, you're expanding your system, right? Your modular system. So as long as it fits to these other pieces, you're good. Look at that. Madness. Does that answer your question, Melon? Trying to see if there's anything else to Oh, one other thing to keep in mind. So we had a window piece, right? Actually, now we can close this and just reopen. Oops. No. So this one is a wall 5x5. Say a window. My questions: what program and what are you making? If you are making anything, what's up, Mole? So we're discussing the building modular building pieces or building sets, and like how to go about doing that. And it's pretty, right now what we're looking at is pretty basic shapes. So we've got three pieces, which are kind of the essentials to like your basic building system. What I'm doing on the stream, usually you can see if you go here, feel free to follow me. And if you're making art yourself, you're totally welcome to share it in the Discord, which is here, and the work in progress section, and everyone's pretty open to critique and discussing making things look better and all that jazz. I'm gonna check Discord actually right now to see where work in progress thread is actually at currently. All right, it's actually pretty small right now. If you guys have anything you want to critique or have me look at, go ahead and just go to the Discord and put it in the whip-art thread. If you're starting to make a modular piece, what is the most important thing to get done first? I would say it's these pieces here. Start with, figure out the height that you want your standard wall to be at. And usually it's, we've talked about Chris, I forget what the rule is called, but let me get the wake on out. The rule of your first floor being 5 meters, and then your second and third floor being 4 meters in height. I think that's just the like building metrics in general. Where's my pen? Oh man. Modo. I'm using Modo, by the way, if you were asking about what program I'm using. Okay, so let's, every time I get rid of that side panel, I need it again. Okay, so let's say this is your building front. I'm like, what the fuck is going on? There we go. Oh yeah, it's an adult stream. Building aesthetics. Yeah, so usually your first floor tends to be taller. No one wants to crit a thesis. Too true, too true. Right now we only got two people to critique. So if you want, I mean, we don't have to critique, but if you want, it's there and we can do it. Okay, so some things to keep in mind. Let's get the good old screenshot this bad boy. Get the old photo poop out. What's up, James Neely 3D? How you doing, man? Thanks for the auto host. It's weird. If it's an auto host, does that mean it's automatic, or does that mean they've triggered the hosting? Never know. Never know. Yeah, I'm still working at Massive on Tay Division. Hide that. Okay, so we got these wall pieces, right? And this is going in at 5 meters right now, 5 meters tall by 5 meters wide. Then we've got a 1 meter by 1 meter corner and another 5 meter blank wall. And then this one, of course, has a window because I've got drawing skills. Normal, like kind of the stuff we use at work is the first floor is 5 meters. And then the next floor is, 4 meters. And then the floor after that is 4 meters. And usually you have, if you're thinking about interiors, the outside is usually pretty basic as far as like how it meets the ground and stuff. Maybe there's a pipe that comes down, like a drain pipe, like so, or like just other elements, a door. So another thing to keep in mind is like, what are the metrics of a door? And the best thing to do is to either find the actual metrics of a door frame, which is good, but tends to be narrow for video games. But making a metrics for a doorway that works well for third person versus first person, those are going to be different. Yeah, that's the only one currently. Building layout guideline tutorial. Ooh, what is this? Yeah, man. This is essentially what we're... Oh, this is good. Actually, this is going in the tutorials archive. I forgot about this. Wait. Simp says, wait. This is good stuff. Because, yeah, you need to essentially look at how everything gets bridged together. Where supports are at, how floors are separated, What's up, Dim? How you doing? Modular environment. Look at Chris dropping the links. That Polycount wiki is super good. Everyone should know that link. Save that jazz. Chris, you're not a moderator on my Discord, man. What's that about? Didn't even ask. But so helpful. But yeah, there's rules to how buildings are built. Yeah, I mean, a lot of the old knowledge is here, right, on those links. But that, I mean, we haven't really changed the way we've built buildings recently as far as, like, how floors are, how we break up floors. You just assumed you were? Oh, wow. The ego on this guy. Oh, snap. It's almost my uncle's birthday. I just got an alert about it. You guys probably didn't see that. So yeah, this is super good. Especially this stuff here. These things that help break up, like, how floors are separated. Little added details. There's usually a detail like this after the first floor. And then there's also awnings, or these top details here, tend to happen where the first floor is ending. You've been doing a lot of programming UE4 or blueprints. Dude, I need to start diving into blueprints. There's some definite benefits to propping and just setting up stuff art-wise. I mean, when we start talking about blueprints, you can do things like you could put this window in a blueprint. This window, say this is all detailed out, right? And you could put this in a blueprint with a number of different things. You have the wall piece, then you have the window frame. Maybe you make a window frame that's broken. Maybe you make a window frame that's got curtains down behind it and one that's got curtains up. And then maybe like a awning, or like a, yeah, it's just an awning. That's essentially blocking rain and sun. Have all of those go in as separate assets, and then place those in the blueprint with toggleable actions, so that you can snap these pieces on, and then you're like, oh, I need this one, I need this piece and this piece. These are two separate blueprints, for example. I need this piece and this piece to have awnings. And then you just would go over to your properties and go tick, tick, and then they've got awnings. Like, oh, this one, I want the window broken. So you just check that on. The window's broken. It's become super helpful if you're making like a street with tons of buildings. Again, that like I'm saying, it's only helpful once you start getting into really large scale stuff. What is this? Are you getting video hiccups? I'm not dropping any frames. You're currently focusing on AI. Dude, cool. Some things to note, I guess, from this doc that's so good. This is basically how you should break down your buildings. Oh, come on. Come on, Photoshop. Don't be like that. So if you're looking at this building, say it's your first floor, right? And then you have like a separator. Wow, the color is not gonna work for us. Is white? Well, maybe. I think it's gonna have to be white because all the other colors are kind of taken. So taking these into consideration and how the floors separate. Looks like these are, this is a support beam, and then having a base piece, and then that base piece being echoed across the where the floors transition. You see that? So it's just like one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. And then having a overhang, which is essentially comes out a bit like that. Maybe it has details that do this. Where these pillars meet, you can do something here to help break up the top piece. And then up here, it's just more modular pieces, right? Like that. So, and then of course, because corners, you've got a corner piece. The mind of manipulation does not work on Tobias. Did it fix Tobias? Oh man, this music's super jazz. Welcome everyone to the stream that's new. Mole and Effects Animator, thanks for the follow. You guys make this possible. I'm Batman. yeah. The other thing is to think about stuff that's additive that's on these. So like you can see he's, the guy who put this together hasn't brought these details out. And you'd probably wanna, I don't even know what those are. Are those even part of the building? Hang on. Oh, it is not part of the building. Okay, so it's like a pole, kind of like a telephone pole, but it's really high. But yeah, this is really good information to look at. Good shiz, man. Good shiz. Dude, this guy even paints out the details just by using colors to emphasize the shapes. Because, like, this basically makes buildings simple. You know what I mean? Yeah, so, Melon, I've already dropped it in the tutorials archive. I guess maybe it didn't drop a image link to it, so I'm just going to do this. I'll grab this and then put that in the Discord. Buildings are very simple to model. Hey, game art. Yeah, they are mostly 90 degree angles. I mean, you have to like think about how do you solve this stuff when you need to break a building, right? And it, like, doing stuff like that becomes quite a bit easier once you have a modular system in place, because you could be like, oh, I need this spot right here, maybe it needs to be bigger, right? Let's see here. This song's weird. So let's say you want these two. You're gonna make this one piece, and then you're going to, we're gonna just draw on it for time's reasons. So let's say you just want to essentially break this open. You're like, oh man, destroyed piece. Dude, as long as that fits inside of this, and your UVs line up here and here, solved. It's like so much easier. So much easier. Yeah, making simple basic buildings is pretty simple. Making shit like that. That is fucking sick. What? That is super cool. Oh man. Oh dude, that's so cool. Yeah, I mean, buildings like this are quite simple, but when you need to start destroying them and maybe you need to make them dynamic, it becomes much easier to get complex. Looks 2D. Good analyzation. Game art. It does look 2D, doesn't it? I think it is. I think it is 2D. Wait, what? Yeah, no, dude, being at work, right, Chris? Easily, this could get dropped into your email, and they're like, so this is how we were thinking about taking the stadium. But, like, could you, let's do this. I mean, you would think I'm joking when it's like, so this is what we want to do. We want to make this. And we want you to be able to enter from here and work your way up the parking garage and then come out in this main street. Actually, no. We'll do even crazier. So you just do this. You go through the parking lot. You fight your way through these like parking lot streets on the third floor. Then you go up an elevator shaft. You go up some other stairs, you see an elevator shaft that's full of water, you dive into it, you swim up, and then you come out in this pool of water here, and then you're revealed this super sick vista of like this overhang of the structure, and you swim your way up to the street, then you have a freaking firefight in this street in the middle here, half submerged in water with bullets flying everywhere, all buildings need to be destructible, and you have 3 months. Oh man, like that's essentially it. That's game development in a nutshell. And then, you know, like halfway through development, everything's looking good. You've got this whole roof piece here. You've solved it in a modular fashion, right? Everything's good. And they're like, oh, when you're fighting here, we want this piece right here. We want this to just like, some random RPG, because a guy doesn't know how to shoot at you, hits up here, and then this whole top piece here, we need this to fall down and collapse, and we need this giant wave of like smoke and debris, and then we need the rest of the fight that happens in there to happen with like smoke and like atmosphere, so you can hardly see the silhouettes of the guys you're shooting at. Solve it. You still have 3 months. This concept is sick though. Like, there's so many cool things you could do with this. This becomes much easier when it's modular as well, though. Levolution. That word, man. I remember when I heard it, and I was like, oh, I don't know. I don't know about that. Okay, so effects animator at your studio. Are the environment artists also responsible for level design, or are they mainly art and level guys come up with play mechanics? I'm trying to figure out how to answer that. So you have environment artists, you have prop artists, and then you have level designers. Level designers block out a space based off of requests from the overarching of like what we want to make. And then you have artists tied together with those level designers, and then they just kind of make the space, get that all checked off, easy peasy. By easy peasy, I mean, you know, it takes some time. That gets all checked off, and then it gets made. That's a very simplified way of doing it, but for my specific position, it's more of working with level designers to make sure that compositionally it looks cool, while also supporting and facilitating fun gameplay. If that makes sense. Oops, we don't want to delete this. We want to delete that. So, yeah. Is there any questions about this modular building stuff while we're here? It's like presentation. Do you also model? Yes. Yes, I do. Effects animator. So there's it's hit or miss with a level designer. What's up, Mel? It is hit or miss with a level designer being strong in composition. I will say it is also hit or miss for a environment artist to have good composition skills, right? But needless to say, the two, like you have a level designer and an environment artist working together, the end result is they need to be compositionally. What the hell are you guys talking about? They need to be working together to make a good composition. And ultimately, if the composition is lacking, you'll hear about it through your art director or your lead or your fellow artists. So it's just a matter of time before that gets hashed out. Non-square UVs and texturing it seamlessly. Ah, yes. I have no idea what Pinion's talking about. Doesn't sound like a guy who wields a sword talks like that. Okay, so let's talk about... So let's say we've got all these pieces, right? We've got handle draw calls. Draw calls aren't necessarily as gnarly as they used to be. They still have their issues, of course. But let's do this. So you have these modular pieces, right? What you could do if you're having draw call issues, you can import all three of these pieces as one object that still are using the same UVs, right? And that'll all be seamless. So you can go from, what is it, 1, 2, 3, 4? 4, 5 pieces for this layout here would be five draw calls. We're talking about modular building design and stuff like that. I kind of plan to just talk about this until it's time to look at your guys' stuff instead of just working on what I'm working on in my spare time. That and I need a little breather because I'm doing a bunch of stuff on the background. So I wouldn't worry too much about draw calls because that's your tech artist will tell you. It's good that you're aware of it and that you understand what draw calls mean and how that happens and how they become too much, because that'll make you build a little bit smarter. And yeah, but your tech artist will tell you if like this is getting ridiculous. You gotta control that. You gotta control those draw calls, man. So let's say you've got all these pieces. As far as I would do it in Unreal, I think this is the only way you could do it, but. So if you want to have some unique masks and things working as far as like, oh, I want drips here and let's do this. Is this helpful to you guys? this isn't necessarily me like arting as usual. Is there something like on the fly texture procedural generation in games going away from big texture data? I don't think so. Chris, does anything come to mind when you think of that, or opinion even? On the fly texture procedural generation. This whole conversation, awesome. This is great to hear. It's great. Let me move this over here. Could be projected, use world, yeah. So, yes. So you have your, you have this face, right? And it tiles going this way in your UVs. These all tile both directions, of course. You do that in your UV set 1, UV set 2, and this is not like, yeah, opinion's right in that regard. You teach online classes, interesting. And with a little monkey face. Okay, so you've got these tiling brick pattern, right? Let's say this is brick. Oh yeah, that Wacom writing skills, so good. So you got brick on UV2, you can do something like either a grind pass or like a material breakup. You could do things like, so let's put grime here. Your brick pattern, instead of making a texture for brick, build a really good normal, right? In a really good normal and a height map in something like Substance Designer, for example. Doesn't have to be. So you've got your brick material. Instead of using the albedo from that, maybe take that and split it into red, green, and blue, and mask out individual bricks, and then plug those into a shader in, say, Unreal, where you can control what color each of these bricks sets are, so that you can change all of your brick colors in the editor. And then you could probably also plug in like a cloud map or like a mask that multiplies. Oh man, this shader thing's drawn completely wrong, but I'm drawing it backwards. So use your cloud map and maybe multiply it on top of this or modulate between that and the other colors. And now you start getting clouded breakup between your colors of your brick. And remember, this is all happening on UV1 still. So you've got color control over brick patterns. You've got cloud masks that you can drag in that help break up those patterns. Then on the other UV set, you've got grime that's also mapped so that it's down here and then up here, right? And then, yeah, you could do that with substance. The problem is if you do that with a substance in an editor, you're now paying for that substance to be live. It's like an updated substance. Dude, I'm totally pouring more coffee right now. This is such a bad idea. I can feel it. I can feel it already. And I think I just saw mud go into my coffee. So that's just your brick stuff. Then you've got your grime. That's happening on top. And then if you bring all of these in, if you give this like material one, material two. These are obviously, these are all the same piece, so these are all going to be material two, and then material three in Modo or whatever your program is. When you bring this in as a single asset, you'll have three materials in it, right? If you build a master shader that works with this, you can then drag that master shader on each one of these. And then it's just a matter of plugging in the masks and plugging in the right brick materials, which could already be built into the master material. Then, on top of all of that, because this is all being brought in as another, as one piece, you could make a UV3. This is where I think you get a lot of like a quality bump that goes quite high because of UV3. And it's weird because this stuff starts to get onto a subconscious level of detail that happens on materials. So in your UV3, you can take all of this stuff and pack it into a single map, right? So once you've done that, once you've done this packing of all five of these pieces into here, you'll have like, you know, all these little, look at this great pack job. Oh, so good. So good. So packed. So once you have UV3 and you have this going on, whoops. In your UV3, and this is where I complain a little bit about something like Substance Painter. Save this out as its own file and delete these two UV sets so that you only have this one. Bring this mesh into something like Substance Painter. And then you can start painting like roughness variation all over the asset itself. Like you're like, oh, I want some like a difference in the roughness here. Maybe I want a little bit more grime. That's just in the roughness. Also in this map, you can get ambient occlusion packed in there. That's just per asset. So like if you have little, if you have a little light sconce thing here, it comes up like that. So say there's a light there and you want dripping here. You can paint that dripping into the UV set 3. You can get all that stuff set up. This light sconce, I would suggest also removing that and putting it in as a separate object and then placing it later. Yeah. And then on top of all of this, you have essentially all of that breakup, right? UV4. There we go. There's a 4. UV4. I mean, I guess you could, because of how you've set up UV3, you can also use UV3 as your light map UVs. But I wouldn't suggest it because the resolution of your light map is going to get messed up because the size and density of that. Yeah, so let's go through the rest of this and then I'll talk about some other options. So UV4, I would suggest each piece has its own UV4 instead of packing them all together. That way you're matching your UVs to your light maps correctly. How do you calculate the pixel aspect ratio? Are you talking about for UV3? Yeah, and UV4 does handle light maps, but like Pinion's saying, poorly. It does an okay job, but it's much better to do it by hand. And actually, let me find. Warren Marshall. So Warren Marshall does a light map thing tutorial. Or a walkthrough of like how light maps work. I believe there's two videos. Definitely watch those. So he talks about how to be light mapping for Unreal. Yeah, so you do all this stuff. UV4, maybe you can dedicate that to your custom setup for your light maps for each of your materials. And then there was one more thing. Oh, like Chris is saying. So with all of this said, like this is the level of like detail that we'll push when we're trying to get a building to look really good in something like The Division or any open world game that has the resources to do 4 UV sets. But with all that said, you can make like, well, shit. Can I draw? Let's see. Sure, that's square. Yeah. No, it's skewed and stretched a bit. You can make a drip pattern like this. You can make a pattern like this that goes up the corner. You can make a pattern that does this, or something that does that. Shit, that might be two. And split it up like this. This would be like an atlas texture. It's a poorly built atlas texture. Normally you could just do these each as a separate thing, as a separate texture. And then using decals, you could, I don't like it. Using decals, these as decals, you can float these on here. So like say there's a pillar here. You could float a quad here. Oops. That does this. And then maybe this has a bit of albedo information, or maybe it's just a roughness shift. So maybe this is a little shinier or wet or whatever you want to do. Just things that you can place. This is like how you would do graffiti as well. So if you wanted to like make a graffiti texture. So this is your quad, right? And you have your graffiti. And this is basically how you do graffiti as well. Oh no. But yeah, that's essentially kind of like a broad look at buildings or modular building pieces and just kind of how to play with the parts and make them work for you. Dude, Division graffiti is the shiz. It is awesome. That's what happens though when you get you have badass concept artists that are like, hell yeah, I'll do some graffiti, and they start building their own style. And then you also have actual graffiti artists from New York City that you contact and get them all making that stuff. I don't even know how. There was a ton of them. Yeah, Chris, you wish UE4's light mask worked like UDK's. UDK's was better. UDK's was better. All right, well, it's 8:32. I guess I can, do you guys have any more questions? I think Epic is fixing the issues, but they have a ton on their plate for all the stuff they need to support for that editor. It'll get back to where the other editor was, but they had to do a full rewrite, correct? So like, it's just gonna take time. Man, I love that concept that you linked, Chris. So cool. So, I guess I'll answer questions while I mess around in Substance Designer. This song is kind of weird. Oh, there's a new update. Sure. I'm sure. Yeah, Fear, you could use UV2 for light mass. It depends how. Yeah, I guess. Yeah, it depends how you're using UV2, but yeah. I mean, basically, all you need is to be mapping your faces so that they align with the pixels for the light map. Freaking hate light maps, man. They sting. They sting so bad. I'm gonna just update Substance Designer really quickly. Let's actually, okay, opinion, I got you. I got you. Let's, we'll close this. We won't save in case we need to look back at some modular building stuff later. How you doing, by the way, Pinion? Life good? Life treating you nice? Just trying to give myself a shape that I can work with. Whoa, that's crazy. There you go. Okay, this song is horribly repetitive. You need to learn Modo. Oh, really? Okay, so you don't want to? There are some things about 3ds Max I miss. I mean, the stack stuff is nice. Texel density, yeah. So Egal or Ega legal. Legal, what's up? So the link that I sent you about Warren Marshall will discuss like making sure that your texel density on your light maps is correct, so that it doesn't get all freaking crazy. The premise, or not premise, the description that is texel density is a semi complicated thing to explain. Oh, you'll figure it out, Chris. There was a really good, if anyone can find it, there was a really good link of someone that basically drew out a really good visual as to how texel density works. If someone can find that, that would be awesome. Installing that. Okay, so all right, Pinion, I got you. So we got this mesh, right? This is your high poly. Sure, right? Sure. So this is cool. This is a thing. We go to another mesh, and I will go to the topo view instead of this Zen thing. This is a whole custom UI thing. So we got our mesh here. We go to the other mesh container. And this is faceted, I think, because inactive is, we'll make this shaded. No? Fine. Default? Okay, sure. We go to the other mesh container. And then a topology pen. As I try and make this work. There we go. Hide the grid. I need to hide the wireframe on the background. Maybe we'll have it super light. Okay, so we go to the topology pen. If you hold down control and then drag out, you'll get a poly. And this is all matching the shape of the surface. And shift dragging will give you desired shape extruding. Shift right clicking will extrude an entire loop or edge length. You've got smoothing, which is basically just like you click it, and then when you click the background, smoothing is now enabled, and you get all of your smoothing properties here, like the strength. But yeah, so let's undo that. We'll smooth. There's some other things you can do, like if I do a topology pen and I drag a poly out over here, if I grab it and bring it to an edge, it'll snap. Let's say we've got four edges there. Let's do three. Let's see what happens here. So select all those edges, select these edges, and then bridge them. Ha! Look at that. Bridge them and make sure that the twist is horribly wrong. Why is that happening? Pina's like, nope. No, it's fucked. No, I don't like it. Forget what causes that, but it's super annoying when it happens. I bet it'll happen too when I go down. The other thing too is while you're in this state, you're still in modeling mode, so you can pull and move stuff around. Let me see if it happens again. Dude, I want to know why that's happening, because sometimes it doesn't happen and sometimes it does. Do you know what causes this, Chris? I just like toggling these on and off. It's hilarious. What do I miss from Max? And is it possible to switch completely? I would say it is possible to switch completely, but then again, I haven't had to do much organic stuff. Chris might be able to answer that question for you. This actually, hang on here. Delete these. Go into this mesh. I'm gonna pull these out here. Do that. I honestly, like, the biggest thing I miss could be vertex normal direction. I think planes are too far from each other to figure out the rotation of the planes out. That might be it, actually. Now, what the hell are we making? It's like a winged dong. We're gonna have to fix that. Anyways, there's some cool stuff like you can do this contour tool, which you just draw a line like that, and it builds a contour spline. You can tell it to be a curve or lines, so then it's more hard-edged, right? And you can turn up the segments, so let's say 23 segments. Hold down shift, do it again over here, and now you have these two. This is where we're probably gonna get into that bridge problem again, but let's see what happens. So when you just select these two and then bridge, there we go. Nice. And then we wanna flip the polygons. So right now we have a bridge happening between these two points. Segment count, you can cut down. Super, super handy. I think I might be able to actually do this and this. Let's see what happens. What the French? You think it'll get confused by this? Well, I did okay with that. Let's see this. So we'll bridge. And then we'll do that, and then we'll deselect this, and then we'll bridge again. Yeah, it's not, I mean, and then you can do like a smooth. I mean, that's not bad, right? That's not too bad. The other thing that I have not done is if you retopo guides. I haven't played with this stuff much. Nice. That looks great. So if I select this guy and do an automatic retopo. There you go. So it's doing an auto retopo as well. This is the most recent, I think, addition to remodeling meshes. Let's see if I can select this one. And then let's do a automatic retopo. Look at that, quads only. Let's do 10% of, yeah. It's not bad. It's pretty fast too, actually. But then again, I mean, this is a pretty simple. So what do I miss? I miss splines. Splines right now in Modo are complete shit. And then there's some better UV tools in 3ds Max currently. I mean, I don't know. I think that's it. I'm sure there's other stuff, but it's just like, I seem to be getting by with things that I need. And the modifier stacks, which they just started doing a bit in here, but it's not there yet. It's not there yet, but it's getting there. Automatic retopo, let's do like 1%. Ho ho, that, nope. 5%? Yeah, okay. I mean, this, I think that could give you a good start. Let's not do quads only. Yeah, I would say that Modo has been doing a pretty good job of, see, this is kind of weird. You gotta like connect that in order to get that crease to happen. Modo's doing a pretty good job of adding content or adding features to their tools currently. This isn't bad though. And from what it looks like, there's retopology guides, but precision. They seem to be they seem to be okay. I wonder if I do this. Let's see what happens. I don't even know if this is how you're supposed to be using it. It's trying to look at what I've drawn. So it looks like you can draw retopology guides and it will listen. And it looks like the guides are also, they're like, what are they? They look like they're splines. So I can just select that and then do an invert. And then delete it if I need to. But yeah. Oh wow, there's 71 of you in here. Hey guys, welcome to the stream. welcome, welcome. If you like what you're seeing, hit that follow button. It would help me out immensely. All right, let's get into designer. Let me see where we're at in the work in progress section. Okay, we only got three things to critique. I might start rolling back some of the older stuff to look at what you guys have been posting. Oh, why does it keep showing it up over there? No. Dimon, thanks, man. Googles, thanks for the follow, dude. I feel weird that I've asked you. It's appreciated though. It means a lot. Opinion, I've actually been meaning to make a video on what I like about Modo. So eventually, we'll get there. There we go. So what this is slowly turning into is a bark material that I'm going to be using on this scene of mine. Where are we at here? Load it up. Reading chat. You guys have been talking quite a bit, which is cool. Super cool. Come on, load Unreal. I'm still on the fence about goggles. Why did I make the switch? So why did I make the switch from 3ds Max to Modo? I liked how Modo was using geometry, if that makes sense. Like, I really like the mesh containers. Like, if I'm in here, the idea that I have mesh containers that I can, like, if you're in Maya, like, this could be a pain in your ass, I'm sure. Or not a pain in your ass, but just more or less not as intuitive. So let's delete that. We'll paste. So see, I've got this geo. Maybe I need to switch to the other UI. This is the UI I like. So if we're looking at this geometry, you can just grab, there we go. You can just grab stuff, copy it, press N, we'll make a new mesh container, paste. So you're treating geometry kind of like you would treat word or text in like a word processing tool. I'm like, that's the weirdest example I've ever made. I also like a lot of the plugins that people have been making for it. So like the Vertex Normal tools are really nice. For you, Pinion, I bet you would really like the bevel profile stuff. That's like, see, you can have empty mesh containers as well. If they're like gray like this, then there's nothing in them. So I'll show you this is like the one thing I really like to show people, because it's something that we're just like, oh man, why, I want that. So if I scale this sphere up, actually let's delete that one. Oh. So if I drag this guy out here, shrink him down. So if I render this, right? Where they're meeting. Balls. Making some balls, guys. Where they're meeting, there's a harsh edge. I like how you can model while you're in this. Anyways, where there's a harsh edge. Harsh edge. You can... if they're using the same material, you can blend how they're interacting with each other. Let me get to that window. So if I go... Actually, I need to have another window up too. This is the properties for the shader. So the shader that's on this guy is this one, base shader. So if I go to round edge width, I can just scale this up. And where they meet, you start to get a bevel. Let's see if we can scale it up a bit more. It's kind of like meta balls, if you remember those. Yeah, effects animator. That's hilarious. Yes, it's like meta balls. You can get those two to merge together like that, just through the render. And that's just happening, like, you know, if I move it. The nice thing is you can take, say, these two objects. Let's get rid of this. I like that the pivot is movable as well. Like, everything's like temporary pivots. So if you look at it like this. So that all that beveling is happening, right? And then you can just duplicate these meshes, boolean them together, and then just, like, I don't know, bake. Bake, and that bevel will come through in your bake. So the normal bakes in this are really nice. As long as you're, obviously, you have to set it to linear when you bake it out. Man, meta balls. I remember meta balls in Bryce 3D. Good stuff. Whoa, uranium. That is crazy. They linked that out? Oh, God. Are they as good as X normal? Are you talking about the normals? I think Matt would be the best guy to ask that. Matt bakes in Modo exclusively now, for the most part. As far as I know, he's baking in Modo exclusively. Is there any way to turn that into Geo? Let me see if I can do that. So if I want to... Oh man, I haven't even played with this yet. Let's look at... let me do this here. So we're going to go to the default UI because I don't know where all that stuff is otherwise. We'll close this. Fusion. New fusion. So we'll just select these two. We'll do a new fusion. We'll do a new fusion from selected meshes. Ha! This guy has no supports, so we need to update that. Actually, we'll just bevel those so it's like that. Oh man, that's hang on. We're gonna do a bevel, but we're gonna do it twice. Okay, so let's say we've got this and we've got this mesh. This is a mesh fusion. I need to select the cube, and then I need to subtract. Is that correct? Oh man, I haven't really played with this much. It's like additive? No? Oh man, I should not be playing with this on stream when I haven't even touched it. What Let's we'll do this. Make a new mesh. Bring it up here. I have no idea if this is gonna work. Stuff's new to me, so. Oh, you can make it primary. Mesh roll to subtractive trim. Whoa. No idea. I'm gonna have to look at this more before I can show you. But mesh fusion is the bee's knees now, man. Let's actually, let me see if I can just. Let's make a new scene. I really want this to work, so we're gonna try it again. Nice, that's a sphere, right? Yeah. Okay, fusion, new fusion. Okay, so we got that. Let's see if we can add another mesh. Like maybe this. Let's do that. It's about time to look at your guys' stuff as well. Let's position it over here. And we'll go back to fusion. This is, yeah. Like, what is happening? Nope, I don't know. I'm gonna have to look it up and get back to you on that stuff. But this is, dude, mesh fusion's pretty slick. It's actually gotten much faster as well. Let me see actually if I can find. We're not even gonna get to substance designer today. Videos. Whoa, there's no music all of a sudden. Wallasaurus coming out of the dark. What's up, man? You need to select both and click trim. Dope. All right, let's do it really quick. You haven't played with it since they updated and changed the way that it works. Man, I need to make it so it quits adding all those loops. Selection wise is pretty nice opinion. So if you like select every other, you can do that. This song, I don't know, man. Let's show them we are better. So if I select both of these and then I click here, I go new fusion from this. I need to take this, add this guy. I'm like, where? So I've got this piece, I've got this one. I need it to do that, and then, oh, so this is changing the role. So now that's primary, this is secondary. I need this to be subtractive. Oh shit, is it working? I'm like, is it working? What's happening to the wireframe? So if I move this into place and then whoa, dude, this is super weird. Yeah, I'm gonna have to play with this more before we look at it. But I can see where it's going, which is pretty cool. Select both and then trim, untrim. It creates a new mesh of the combo. Whoa, okay, yeah, I'm gonna have to look at that later. We have to look at your guys' stuff now. Thanks, Wallosaurus. I can't even... Wallosaurus? Wallosaurus? He spoiled... What the... Oh, shit, it's happening. I'm still working on that article that Level 80 is going to post about me. That's awesome. For some reason, it was freaking out on you. That's how it works. When you try and show someone something, it freaks out. Okay, so Danro, thanks for the auto host, man. We're at 56 viewers, guys. And maybe a little more, we'll see. Welcome people that may be here. I didn't see if it was saying how many people came in on the auto host. The geo actually comes out as if you've done a very clean boolean, as if you've modeled it. It's kind of crazy. No, it comes out exactly what you would expect as far as like a high poly mesh. Okay, so face melt, you're first, buddy. Can't hide anything for long now on the internet. Ugh. It's true. Okay, so this is super cool. Super, super cool. This isn't 3D, of course. But it's friggin' awesome. This is from Face Melt. Face Melt 84. Get the Wacom out. I mean, I don't have anything to draw on this, really. I mean, it looks cool. It's a cool steady. Let's actually give me a second, guys.